Hello and most welcome to 1261 of the Heidegger series. And I would today mention an article made by Lise Molin and Nancy Cartwright. It's named On Doing Physics in Quantum and Classical Boxes. Introduction. Lise Molin, Doing Physics in a Quantum Box. In Lise Molin's book, Time Reborn, From the Crisis in Physics to the Future of the Universe, there's a chapter called Doing Physics in a Box. That chapter is the basis of this piece. Doing physics in a box has a long history. According to the theoretical physicist Lise Molin, it goes back to Kepler, Galileo, Descartes, and Newton in the 16th and 17th centuries. These scientists learn to isolate little pieces of the world, examine them, and record the changes to them. So, how did they do this? Smolin writes, they showed us how to display the records of these motions in simple diagrams whose axes represent the position and times in a way that is frozen and hence amenable to being studied at our leisure. Smolin's reference to frozen time hints at another major concern of his. The reality of time, this can't be discussed here. Ironically, some of the thought experimental boxes of physics are literally boxes. For example, we have Erwin Schrödinger's famous cat in a box thought experiment. And Albert Einstein's light box experiment. Interestingly enough, both experiments show the impact of outside forces on the boxes. In the cat in the box case, outside disturbances can collapse the wave function. Or as Philip Ball puts it, Schrödinger's cat might be placed inside a sealed box. But there must be air in there for the cat to have any chance of staying alive. And the cat is resting on a surface of some kind, exchanging heat with it. Ball then admits that if the environment is included at all in most scientific theories or analysis of experiments, it is often simply considered to be the source of a little random disturbance, which can, with sufficient care, be kept to a minimum. Then comes the warning. But in quantum mechanics, the environment has a central role in how things happen. As for Einstein's light box experiment, let Manjit Kumar explain the problem. Bohr held that any measurement of the position of the light box would lead to an inherent uncertainty in its momentum, because to read the scale would require it to be illuminated. The very act of measuring its weight would cause an uncontrollable transfer of momentum to the light box because of the exchange of photons between the pointer and the observer, causing it to move. What's more, in his desperation to destroy the Copenhagen view of quantum reality, Einstein had forgotten to take into account his own theory of general relativity. He had ignored the effects of gravity on the measurements of time by the clock inside the light box. Later in this piece, the philosopher Nancy Cartwright specifically confronts Galileo's little piece of the world. A ball on an inclined plane. However, Smolin himself concentrates on quantum pieces of the world. Lee Smolin, doing physics in a quantum box. The words quantum box are used because Smolin focuses on such a thing. He says that the application of quantum mechanics appears to be limited to isolated systems. Yet, it is still an extension of the Newtonian paradigm of doing physics in a box. Nonetheless, he mentions classical or macro boxes too. Smolin has two important things to say about the experiments of physics. The first is that what he calls subsystems or isolated systems are inevitably part of the entire universe. Therefore, they're also affected by the whole universe. Two, the experiments are extremely artificial constructs. And the very most artificial aspects are the selected initial conditions of the experiment. Initial conditions. As for initial conditions, Smolin writes, when we do an experiment in a laboratory, we control the initial conditions. We vary them to test hypotheses about laws. Then comes Smolin's very particular addition. But when it comes to cosmological observations, the initial conditions were set in the early universe. So we must make hypotheses as to what those were. The words above highlight Smolin's larger cosmological concerns. So not only does Smolin emphasizes the fact that closed systems are actually open systems. Delimited for the purpose of the experiment, that is open to the entire universe. He also notes that the present universe's own initial conditions were set in the early universe. Smolin supplies us with more details on initial conditions. Firstly, they determine the beginning of any experiment. Smolin writes, "You specify which history describes a particular experiment when you give the initial conditions. Thus, to predict the future or to explain something, it is not enough to know the laws. You must also know the initial conditions. In laboratory experiments, this is easy because the experimenter prepares the system to start in some particular initial condition. Smolin in the above writes, it's not enough to know the laws. He then cites Galileo's law of falling bodies. This states that thrown balls, in this case, will trace a parabola. So what were the initial conditions of this act of ball throwing? And which parabola will be exemplified? Smolin says that the answer is determined by how fast and at what angle and from which location he threw the ball. That is, by the initial conditions. Earlier on, Smolin had said that one law has an infinite number of solutions, each of which describes a possible history of the system in which the laws are satisfied. Thus, in the ball throwing example, we have the one law, which is Galileo's law of falling bodies. In the case of Danny throwing the ball, its history is determined by how fast, at what angle, and from which location he threw the ball. This is a single solution of Galileo's law of falling bodies. Isolated and open boxes. Let Smolin define an isolated system. He writes, a subsystem of the universe modeled as if it were the only thing in the universe, neglecting everything outside it, is called an isolated system. In a certain sense, it seems incredible that physicists would treat a subsystem as if it were the only thing in the universe. Of course, physicists obviously know that their subsystem isn't the only thing in the universe. However, for the purpose of the experiment, that's indeed how it is seen. That raises the question as to why it's seen that way. Now, if we have isolated systems, we must also have systems which aren't isolated. These are called open systems. Smolin writes, to one extent or another, subsystems of the universe are always what physicists call open systems. These are bounded systems that interact with things beyond those boundaries. Again, it seems obvious that no subsystem or isolated system can really be bounded. It can be treated as if it were bounded, though clearly it isn't in reality. Yet in many respects, treating the entire system, treating the entire universe as part of an experiment or subsystem, the latter being, of course, Smolin's concern, doesn't make much sense. Or at least, it doesn't make much sense for practical or everyday scientific purposes. Interestingly, in the context of experiments, open systems become isolated systems. That is, in order to do an experiment, the open system must be made into an isolated system. In Smolin's words, a great deal of the craft of experimental physics consists in turning open systems into approximately isolated systems. We can never do this perfectly. The problem here is that, as Smolin puts it, physicists need to shield their experiments from contamination, from outside vibrations, fields, and radiations. In addition, what is important to decipher is what are the forces that the system is subject to in each configuration. What's more, for many experiments, this suffices, but some experiments are so delicate that they are affected by noise from cosmic rays hitting the detectors. This particular problem can be solved by putting the laboratory in a mine several miles underground in order to detect neutrinos from the sun. Smolin continues, neutrino detectors buried deep in the ice of the South Pole record. Record neutrinos that have entered at the North Pole and travel all the way through the Earth. And then there is gravity and gravitational waves, Smolin ants. In principle, nothing can screen out the force of gravity or stop the propagation of gravitational waves. So nothing can be perfectly isolated. I discovered this important point during my PhD studies. I wanted to model a box that contained gravitational waves bouncing back and forth inside. But my models kept failing, because the gravitational waves passed right through the walls. The final upshot of all this is to realize that to incorporate everything that might impinge on our laboratory from the outside would require a model of the whole universe. And because of that, we must base our physics on approximations. Truncation of nature. Smolin often uses the words truncation of nature. This idea closely parallels his notion of isolated systems, in that nature is truncated or simplified in the experiments of physicists. In addition, the theories of physics are also truncated. These truncations aren't all about factoring out irrelevant detail, which could be huge in extent. No, truncations factor out, or so Smolin argues, factors that may well be hugely important. Still, Smolin accepts that truncations are necessary when it comes to both the experiments and the theories of physics. Nonetheless, both cosmologically and philosophically, There's a larger picture which needs to be considered. It needs to be considered not only for philosophical or cosmological reasons. It also needs to be considered because the boxes of physics may well be sending us in the wrong direction. One truncation offered by Smolin is all about designing experiments to isolate and study a few degrees of freedom, ignoring the rest of the universe. There's a truncation at the level of experiment. We also have truncations at the level of theories. Thus, all the theories we worked with, including the standard model of particles physics and general relativity, are approximate theories applying to truncations of nature that include only a subset of the degrees of freedom in the universe. We call such an approximate theory an effective theory. One way we can look at this is to say that we never have absolute truth in physics. Indeed, as many physicists and philosophers have argued over the years, that's a damn good thing, too. Thus, if these theories weren't approximate, then they'd be final and complete. And if they were final and complete, then physics would come to an end, at least in the domains in which this is applied. Thus, we have the pragmatic or instrumentalist term, effective theory instead. Now Nancy Cartwright, Doing physics in a classical box. In order to draw out regularity and systematicity from experiments, Nancy Cartwright says that it takes an enormous amount of effort in special background conditions, in special circumstances, before you get regular, repeatable behavior. This highlights the stress which Smalling too puts on initial conditions. To put the point crudely, if you change the initial conditions, you change everything. This also highlights the selection process, which experimenters need to indulge in. And then Smalling himself makes similar points in his books. The Trouble with Physics, The Rise of String Theory. In that book, he writes, "It is often the case that surprising experimental results are not confirmed when other experimentalists repeat the experiment." This does not mean someone is being dishonest. Experiments on the edge of what is possible are always hard to replicate. And it's typically difficult to separate noise from a meaningful signal. All this clearly goes against the rather naive idea that physics is all about observation and consequential making sense of what is observed. In other words, physics is also about asking nature questions and manipulating nature. A ball on an inclined plane. Cartwright gives her own example of the artificiality and specificity of experiments in the following. I think that you learn about certain situations or certain properties, what capacities they have, and you can also learn about the capacities they have by putting them in very specific circumstances. Like if you put a ball on an inclined plane and make it as frictionless as possible, and you try to learn from that about the capacity of something with an inertial mass, say, to keep moving unless acted upon by a force to make it stop. Clearly, this particular experiment is a long way from Smolin's isolated systems, in that it's dealing with medium-sized dry goods. Not subatomic particles, forces, fields, radiations, etc. In any case, there are two things one can learn about the capacities of certain situations or certain properties, namely, one, we can discover what capacities are prevalent only in certain situations, and two, the capacities are displayed by putting them in very specific circumstances. One can argue that situations or properties never have certain capacities in themselves, because neither situations nor properties are ever entirely taken as they are in themselves. That is, both situations and properties are always embedded in particular contexts and can never be found outside them. Thus, properties and situations act the way they act precisely because they're in specific contexts or conditions. It follows that they never act the same in all contexts and in all sets of conditions. In physics, these conclusions will work against our modelizing tendencies and the penchant to think in terms of universal generalizations. Thus, in the case of Cartwright's own example of a ball on an inclined plane, which is as frictionless as possible, will not always be able to come across frictionless planes or even frictionless balls. Basically, this is a scientific setup. It's an experiment. However, if we don't construct these initial conditions, then we'll never learn about the capacity of something. Perhaps frictionless planes don't ever occur naturally, or at least not often. So this experiment may never actually be replicated in nature, at least not the full extent required to see what happens to balls when placed upon an inclined plane. This doesn't mean that we don't learn something about nature, even if nature includes any planes which are frictionless. One of the problems with these experiments is that one mustn't only select what it is one wants to find out. One must also select the circumstances and conditions which will tell you what it is you want to find out. Different initial conditions will tell you different or different things. And even so, even the same initial conditions can tell you different things depending on what it is one is looking for. As Cartwright puts it, now the characterizing behavior is often associated with constructing some special circumstances in which that characterizing behavior is exhibited, or almost or approximately exhibited, like the frictionless plane. But the question is, why are those circumstances particularly interesting circumstances? What's so special about them? They are, after all, just some circumstances. You could have this degree of friction, that degree of friction, you might not think about friction at all, but something else, and you might paint the inclined plane red. This simply means that the initial conditions must be selected in the first place. Not only that, evidently different initial conditions will produce different effects or further conditions. In addition, the very same initial conditions may result in different conclusions for the experimenter depending on the questions he wants answering or the things he wants to test. Thus, there is a selection process involved all the way down the line. From the selection of the initial conditions to how the same or different initial conditions are interpreted by the scientific experimenter. We'll have to put the conclusion in the next episode. I say thank you very much. It was great delight having you. That's a bit of the nightly view here. It's been dark since an hour and a half back. Bye-bye.